Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing the proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of His eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelations given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Tinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada and certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and title for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It had been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It had been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been improperly substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there letter J in the English language until 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, He is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose the cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation and sum total of the universe abides within this pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this selfsame spirit manifested Himself in a physical body and walk the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach about the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof of that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First, is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, our nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons, our children of Yahweh. Ninth, is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained there is no other name given among men, whereby man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. We have a prayer this evening by Dr. Samuel Salas and a scripture lesson of Ezekiel the 28th chapter by Dr. Bud Wunsch.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for allowing us to be here tonight for the purpose of learning about you and your purpose and your plan. I hope tonight you pour in us many things in our memory, that way we can give hear a good class of the dead, burial, and resurrection of your only Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say
hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Tonight's scripture will be taken from the 28th chapter of Ezekiel. I'll be reading to you from the Holy Name Bible. This was critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts and revised by the late E.B. Trena. He happened to be an Italian Jew and he was associated with the Scripture Research Association Incorporated. This particular copy was reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. Ezekiel 28. The word of Yahweh came again unto me, saying, Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, Thus saith Yahweh, Because thine heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am Elohim, I sit in the seat of Elohim, in the midst of the seas, yet thou art a man and not Elohim, though thou set thine heart as the heart of Elohim. Behold, thou art wiser than Daniel. There is no secret that they can hide from thee. With thy wisdom and with thine understanding, thou hast gotten thee riches, and hast gotten gold and silver into thy treasures. By thy great wisdom and by thy traffic, hast thou increased thy riches, and thine heart is lifted up because of thy riches. Therefore, thus saith Yahweh, Because thou hast set thine heart as the heart of Elohim, behold, therefore I will bring strangers unto thee, the terrible of the nations, and they shall draw their swords against the beauty of thy wisdom, and they shall defile thy brightness. They shall bring thee down to the pit, and thou shalt die the death of them that are slain in the midst of the seas. Wilt thou yet say before him that slayeth thee, I am Elohim? But thou shalt be a man, and not Elohim, in the hand of him that slayeth thee. Thou shalt die the deaths of the uncircumcised by the hand of strangers, for I have spoken it, saith Yahweh. Moreover, the word of Yahweh came unto me, saying, Son of man, take up a lamentation unto the king of Tyrus, and say unto him, Thus saith Yahweh, Thou sealest up the sum, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of Elohim. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardius, topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of Elohim. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created, till iniquity was found in thee. By the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of Elohim, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings that they may behold thee. Thou hast defiled the sanctuaries by the multitude of thy iniquities, by the iniquity of thy traffic. Therefore will I bring forth a fire from the midst of thee. It shall devour thee, and I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. And they that know thee among the people shall be astonished at thee. Thou shalt be a terror, and never shalt thou be any more. Again the word of Yahweh came unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against Sidon, and prophesy against it, and say, Thus saith Yahweh, Behold, I am against thee, O Sidon, and I will be glorified in the midst of thee, and they shall know that I am Yahweh, when I shall have executed judgment in her, and shall be sanctified in her. For I will send into her pestilence, and the blood into her streets, and the wounded shall be judged in the midst of her by the sword upon her on every side. And they shall know that I am Yahweh.
And there shall be no more a pricking briar unto the house of Israel, nor any grieving thorn of all that are found, all that are around about them that despise thee. And they shall know that I am Yahweh. Thus saith Yahweh, when I shall have gathered the house of Israel from the people among whom they are scattered, and shall be sanctified in them in the sight of the heathen, then shall they dwell in their land that I have given to my servant Jacob. And they shall dwell safely therein, and shall build houses and plant vineyards. Yea, they shall dwell with confidence when I have executed judgment upon all those that despise them round about them, and they shall know that I am Yahweh their Elohim. Ezekiel the 28th.
Hallelujah.
Our first speaker this evening will be Dr. Laurie Lawless. I got it.
Oh, okay.
I got it.
You sure?
Yeah.
Wow, good evening, folks. Yeah. That's a pleasant surprise. I mean, you know, say you never know when Reggie on the floor, you know, you're always going to call. But nevertheless, you want to be ready, you know, to give a reasonable testimony. And it's always a pleasure to be able to stand up and testify to some of the things that Yahweh has bestowed upon me to see about his purpose and plan of salvation. And you know, it's like a, this is a history lesson, you know, or his story that we are looking at. Every time we come down here, we review a little bit more about the purpose and plan of our Heavenly Father, Yahweh. And when I first came out here, like everybody else, you're looking around at all these charts and you're saying, man, what's going on here? I mean, if this is a school, give me an F, because I would never pass, you know. But when you're thinking carnal, you're going to always feel that you can't compete with this. But that's the thing, you're not competing in this teaching, you know. It's all based upon what Yahweh showed you, you know. I mean, he never said that I'm only going to pick those that have a high IQ, 180 or whatever, you know.
That's right.
It's about, he exemplified that when he pulled David on the side, you know, who was a tender sheep, right? You know, I mean, as a boy, you know, and had him to do great, magnificent things, you know. And so, you know, we come down here and we try to get a knowledge and wisdom, a knowledge and understanding of exactly the mystery. Because let's face it, this thing called life is a mystery. And if Yahweh shares it with us and shows us how we got to where we are now, what we're all about is what he's all about. And we come to the realization that no matter how difficult life is, he's always there to lift you up, you know? I mean, everybody has their own personal testimony, you know, about what the things that Yahweh has done for them. And I think that's about the greatest achievement of all, is to be a one-on-one with your Heavenly Father. Somebody get for me Proverbs 14 and 12.
Proverbs 14 14 to 12. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death.
There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof, they said the end thereof are the ways of death? Or
there is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death.
See, it said, but the end thereof are the ways of death. See, now, when Yahshua the Messiah walked the Palestinian Judean hills, he was asked and many things. Of course, they interrogated him, you know. They put him under a fine magnifying glass, you know, because they didn't really want to accept who he was. Nevertheless, you know, he kept saying, I am the way, the truth, and the light, you know. And now, even back then, the purpose of the Son, or the will of the Father, was for the Son to come in, okay, and work a work in our day that we wouldn't believe. You know, one of the things that's contained in that work is the word fulfilled. See what I'm saying? Which, prior to any of us coming here, we always thought that meant, well, you know, that's to start something up, you know, to really, you know, start something or institute something. But it wasn't until we came down here and put that word into application to find out what it really meant, which means to bring something to an end, see, to close, performance for the last time, bring it to an end. And that word has pretty much floored the entire world, you know, because I'm talking about Roman Catholics, all the way back down to the holy rollers in the back door, snake charmers and everything. They feel that they have to do something, right, in order to earn a rite of passage into the kingdom. And so what we're looking at is a word that means just the entire opposite, you know? And that's one of the main things that we try to push here when people first come down here. We want them to see what this teaching is all about, you know. And a lot of times they'll come here and they will sit under this teaching. And all of us who've been down here for some time, we hope that they would be, you know, that they would see something, Yahweh would show them something, to the point where they would come back and feed some more. Because that's the way it was with all of us, right? I'm pretty sure everyone last one was our testimony. The reason why we're still here is because the first time we were visitors, Yahweh had mercy on us. While you're here, he showed us something. A lot of people come down here and they come that close, you know what I'm saying? And they don't really see a thing. Because they go right back out there, you never see them again. You know, and you call them up, they say, oh, you know, they make excuses, you know. And every last one of us can testify to that, you know. But it was his mercy,
yes.
You see, that said, well, I'm going to let Lloyd see something, you know. And I realized that now. When I first came here, I said, yeah, this is cool, you know, y'all learning stuff, you know. It looks like you got some kind of pattern, you know. It was like all out there, too much for me to take in all at one time. Yeah. And so, you know, I had a dream that the first day I came down, was a fellow by the name of Stanley Dunn.
Yeah,
Joe knows it, yes. Stanley, you know. Stanley, we were like custodians for this unified school district, and they sent us different places, you know. Just so happened, he and I happened to meet up at this particular school, and we were on our lunch hour kicking it, and we were talking about certain things, you know, the wonders of the world, you know. And somehow we got on the subject of God, you know. And he was already in this teaching. And he told me, well, did you know that God is a title and not a name? I said, oh, yeah, I know that. But when you put it into application, you come up with the Heavenly Father. You know, it's treated like a name, you know. And I said, well, wait a minute now. Theologians and, you know, Jews and Catholics, they can't be wrong. You know, everybody at that particular time, you know, was talking about the Pope. And, you know, back then, it was Pope John Paul, something like
23rd,
I believe, yeah. And, you know, it's the same thing they're doing now. Oh, the Pope. You know, it's like I said, you got to whisper it, it's so sacred, you know. But we, after coming into this teaching, we found out that that is not the mediator between man and the Heavenly Father, which they claim they are, you know. And they claim that Peter came to Vatican City, which at that time was still under construction because it took 120 years to build that cathedral out there, you know. But, you know, those were words coming from out of their mouths saying, well, yeah, you know, that's what gives us the right, you know, to be the mediator between, you know, God and man. It was Peter, one of the apostles, St. Peter, you know, and he gave us the key to the kingdom. I want to show you something right here. The Moses chart. See, that's, see, he had to transfigure, you know, in the presence of Peter, James, and John in a vision. And it says Joshua's, and this is sunset. See, he, the sun did rise and set. Back, this is under the fulfillment clause. Okay, I'll put it that way. But you see these little dots here? You see that? And how they come all the way down here? See, now, you can't see it too good, but in this hand he has the key. He's holding the key.
Uh-huh.
You see? And then that, and now we can look at that and say, oh man, you're not wondering anymore what that little thing was all about, right? Because after this teaching, you realize that when he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, I am the door, well, every door needs a key, isn't that right? To unlock, just like our consciousness, our awareness. Mm-hmm. See, unless that door to our consciousness is unlocked, we're still in the dark, you see? But looking at him rising up from the dead, you see, as a quickening spirit, the first fruit of those that slept in the face of the earth, going all the way back to Adam, all the way up to that present time when he rose up out of that tomb. And he's holding the key up, you know? And you can pretty much hear what that scripture is, Joe, it's, oh, death, where is thy sting? You know? I can just hear him saying that now, you know, he's holding it up, you know. I'm the man, that's what he, pretty much, you know. Because no one else has ever done that. Now, there were followers, you know. There were followers. I would go as far as to say back, way back there with Adam and them, see. Because you had Cain coming, you know, out of the womb, and he pretty much set up, you know, his own kingdom, you know, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So I mean that opposition or that satanic spirit that was way back there after the fall of Adam is the same one traveling down through the ages too. See, Yahweh's coming. I mean, Yahshua's coming down through the ages, and so is he. And in the fulfillment, oh, he's right on his heels. You know, he's pretty much, you know, trying to figure out exactly what this thing is all about, what the Messiah is doing. You see that serpent there?
Yeah.
You know, he's coming all down to the Edenic transgression, the flood, the Tower of Babel, Abraham. Mm-hmm. See, that's that bad boy coming down there, see. Mm-hmm. Now we understand what this snake is doing here at the heels of the Messiah, because it's a scripture that says he will feed at his head and his heels. Something like that. I haven't got that. But that's as far as he can go. You see what I'm saying? Over here, when he ushered in the age of grace, poured out his spirit into the hearts and minds of those Jews back here, I think it was the apostles, and it was a total of 120, I think. What was it?
Oh, the Pentecost.
You only did Pentecost. You see, and that's that symbolic dove there showing how that woman that's clothed in the sun, see, how that symbol is a reflection of this day of Pentecost. Remember Jeremiah 31:31. Somebody get that for me, will you?
Jeremiah 31:31. Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith Yahweh. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith Yahweh. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people.
See, here we go. The law of Moses, written on a table of stones, okay? The law of the Spirit, kingdom of Joshua, is written in the hearts and minds of men. See? Now we have a chance to be partakers of that beautiful day, you know, the day of atonement, because now that the Holy Spirit is in man, that's the law in himself. See, when he came out of that body, when he rose out of that tomb and was tarried on the earth plane for like 40 days, right? Still going by the pattern, even after he rose, and ascended to the Father, and then 10 days later, ushered in the Holy Spirit. Jews first and then Gentiles. See, but now prior to that, he had told the people that was questioning him and putting him under magnifying glass and that, trying to trip him up and everything. He told them, you know, to begin with Moses, right? Let's get that John 5:43, is it? Search the scriptures, I want to get that.
John 5:39. Ye search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. But ye will not come to me that ye might have life. I receive not honor from men.
Okay, I received that honor from men. Go ahead.
But I know you, that you have not the love of Elohim in you.
See, I know you. You don't have the love of Elohim in you, see? Why? Because he had the Holy Spirit, and it had not been dispensed yet to the point where it was going to be a permanent fixture in the hearts and minds of men. Yeah, you had men, holy men of Yahweh, spoken they were moved by the Holy Spirit. That's true, you see? But that Holy Spirit wouldn't remain in them back then, see? You know, holding that spot, Yahweh spoke and then moved by the Holy Spirit. When that Holy Spirit got to you, Jeremiah and Isaiah, you see, all those prophets back there, you know, they spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. And then after that, they went on about their business, whatever they were doing. See? But here he is saying that I'm going to write my law in the inward parts, you see? See? Because up here, I'm sorry, just finish reading that out.
I am come in my Father's name, and you receive me not.
I come in my Father's name, and you receive me not. See?
Let another come in his own name, him you will receive.
See, now the world has received so many different prophets out there. I mean, and you talk about the preachers of L.A. You ever see that?
Oh, yeah.
Man. These guys, they're flashing their jewelry and their neck pieces. One of them got Rolls Royce, boy. Yeah. This dude pulling Rolls Royce. He said, well, and I caught one of the episodes, I was just cracking up and he said, well, I think these two so-called preachers, they're in the car riding around in the hood, because that's where they grew up, that's what they said. You know? Mm-hmm. And he said, I'm going to go back to my brothers and see if I can lift them up out of that, you know, that dark anguish, you know. And, you know, but they're flashing, you know, I'm looking at the rings, I'm looking at the neck pieces, I'm looking at the clothes, the attire, the automobile. Mm-hmm. I said, people actually believe in these guys, you know? Mm-hmm. They actually will give up all their money because they feel that is a tangible blessing. See, it's all about tangible blessings with the world. With us, it's the blessing of the Holy Spirit, which is knowledge and wisdom of how your Heavenly Father accomplished your salvation. How did he do that? And he's telling you right now, was you before Moses, you don't have to get it, but there are other scriptures too where he was saying to those rabbinical scribes and Pharisees, before Abraham was, I am. Search the scriptures. Lo, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me to do thy will, O Yahweh. You see? All kind of clues. In other words, let's go back. I'm going to be obedient and go back. But I just had to take it to that point. Like I said, pick it up by the tail. You know, when Moses picked up that serpent, picked up by the tail. Well, this is the tail of that serpent. See? And this history lesson that we're talking about, coming on down through the ages of dispensation, at this point, you know, it's a big old fat lie from the Pope on down to the Holy Rollers. So that's what people's head is, see? It's about churches coming in buildings made with hands and worshiping an idol or something, see? But he's telling, but if they wanted to know what he was all about, you got to be obedient. You got to go back to the law of Moses. And when you get back here, you find that he was a raised in Pharaoh's house, you see? And after that death decree that was put out, all the male babies, Jewish babies, under Hebrew children under the age of two, the death decree, his life was spared, and Yahweh allowed him to come on out of that satanic place, Egypt. And he became a tender of sheep back here. Now Yahweh's ready to work with him. He sees him at the burning bush. He tells him, calls out his name. Moses said, well, here I am, you know, and they begin the conversation. He tells Moses, he gave him a little history lesson. He said, now I am the Elohim of your fathers, Jacob, Joseph, and everything. In other words, he went on back down to the genealogies and pedigrees and told him. But my name back then, I was known as Yahweh. El Shaddai, see, the Almighty, which means the Almighty Provider, see. But by my name Yahweh was I not known to them. But it's a perfect time to introduce my name, and this is going to be my name forever and throughout all generations. So he told him his name was Yahweh. Because see, Moses, after he was understood what Yahweh wanted him to do, he said, well, wait a minute now, Yahweh. Now, I was raised in Egypt. And everything that exists in Egypt is somehow another related to some kind of God with a name. So I can't go down there and just, you know. So he asked him for a name, and that's when he kind of gave him a general history lesson and told him, you know, he said, Aya Asher Aya. Now in your King James Bible, it'll say Aya Asher. I am that I am. You see, and we ate that up. Our ignorance, we accepted that, you know. And anybody you talk to, they could be a scholar, a theologian, or whatever. They'll say the same thing. Well, yeah, right there in the Genesis, it says that, you know, I am that I am. And then the movie comes out with it. The movie, back in 1940-something, with Cecil B. DeMille, put together the Ten Commandments, and they had, I read an article somewhere where they said, well, when they first put the movie together, they had scholars, so-called religious scholars, architects and historians. You know how you hire people when you're doing a movie that involves historical facts or whatever. And these guys, they come with some heavy credentials, see? So their input in that movie was wrong too, you see? But nevertheless, that's what, you know, that's what they had. But now here Moses goes down in Egypt, you see? He had to tell Pharaoh, Yahweh said, let my people go. And naturally he told Moses, now it's not hard enough your heart. So, you know, you're going to have to, I'm going to harden up his heart. I'm sorry. Yahweh said, I'm going to harden up Pharaoh's heart. And so I'm going to get 10 devastating plagues out of it, you see. But then, nevertheless, it's just, you know, like, roll with me here because we're going to do this, you know. And that's what happens, see. And then Moses comes out with the children of Israel into the wilderness of Sinai, right? And here you go. When he comes up out of there, Yahweh tells him to gather around the mountain, see, because the next thing he's going to speak to him, which he thundered down those words, the Ten Commandments, to the Israelites, and they shaked and quivered and everything, man. And they told Moses, you go, you know, you go on up there, Moses talked to him, you know, because we can't deal with that. Then it was too loud and everything was shaking, you know. So here's Moses going up to that mountain, talks to Yahweh, sees what Yahweh was doing with everything that Yahweh said, he wrote it down in a book, you see. And Moses made that second trip up there, when Yahweh called him up, he told him to come on up and hew out two tables of stone, and I'm going to write, you know, on those stones. And Moses brought those tables of stones up there, and Yahweh was showing him how he brought into existence the creation by illustrating through Yahshua, because Yahshua, who was Moses' minister, was the one that's transfigured,
right?
You see,
that's right,
in front of the 74 of the people here. They were witnessing to him, see, and here's Moses here, he's seen the Elohim of Israel, and they described him as having feet and hands and everything, so it was pretty descriptive. They saw something magnificent. But then after a short while, they grew impatient, went on back down there and got caught in, and here they are over here, they built a golden calf. And that's when the same Yahshua called to Moses. He said, now, there's something going on in that camp. You hear that noise, Moses? So Moses going out there with the table of stones that Yahweh gave him. He goes down there, what's going on? I don't see him here no more. You know, they were told to wait at the foot of the mountain, you know, the plateau. And now they're gone. I mean, and that's Aaron, his brother. They identified as 70 elders. The same ones who saw the Elohim of Israel, you see, were the same ones that was part of that golden calf worshiping. Right?
That's right.
And not only that, they said, this be the one that brought us out of Egypt. I'm looking at this one, you see. But they gave credit and homage to this one.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? That's something to think about. You know, I'll get to that later. But it just goes to show you how it's either this one or this one. Now here's Moses, he's seeing the Elohim, and he sees the same Elohim transfigure into this threefold tangible tabernacle right here, in part. And then he changes back into his whole self again. Mm-hmm. And then he used that same recapitulation image to bring in this scene to start hashing out the days. First day, you know, separating the darkness from the light, the waters above and the waters beneath. On the third day, the seed of vegetation came on in and rose up into fruition. And then on the fourth day, the seasons, right? You had the spring, summer, spring, winter, fall, you know, not necessarily in that order. But you had the seasons coming into existence, and the sun itself went on up into the city in its highest form, see? And then on the fifth day, the animal kingdoms, we're talking about the sky, land, and sea. And then we got the sixth day, we got Adam, the man, being formed from the dust of the earth. See? And you see how that Adam, you see the sixth day is lines up right here between the two. This is like it played 11 and 12.
Very good.
That you see back there.
That's correct.
And then you can see how the woman was taken out from the man, and Adam was put to sleep, you know, and the woman was removed from Adam's rib in his womb, see? And they produced the woman. And then, boy, you know what I need? I need to make this world, because I want to show. I just want to show on those veils how important those veils are, you know. You can put it right on the side of here, Jim. That'll work. Yeah. That'll work, yeah, thanks. See, now here's the, oh, by the way, the charts will be ready Wednesday, I forgot to tell you. Here's that incision from his side, just like with that soldier that pierced his side, you know, in fulfillment, you know, of this right here, you see. And here is the first veil that we see, it says division of the sexes. That's because Yahweh had removed the woman from the man's rib and womb, right? And then you go into the most holy place, it says unity of masculine and feminine sexes. So now it's a unity. Here, it shows forth a division, see? Because the woman was removed, taken out. Here, it shows the unity. Even though she's not put back in, but the vows that Adam had spoken of was in uniting of the two souls, you see? And even though they were sitting there holding hands and they in that tight union, it was like a, you know, like the minister says, the nuptials between man and woman, they got, do you take this woman to be your lawful wife, blah, blah, blah. Well, that's pretty much what happened here. And you see how the unity of the sexes are, you see? So now we're looking at the same thing here. This is like plate 11 and 12. This is like plate 11 and 12. And you can see how that one was taken out. Here is that they show man and woman divided. Here it shows man and woman united, you see? Right. And so that is why you can see the six line up like in between, because it's representing both of those plates. Plate 11 and 12 is a representation of the unity of the division and unity of the spirit. It's illustrating how that came about, you see. And then when Moses comes down, you see, and he heard that noise, and he dealt with it by taking that golden calf and grinding it down and pretty much made like a liquid drink out of it. You know, they had to drink it. And, you know, that was one of those kind of things where, you know, you had that discussion, you know, where, you know, either this is going to be a savior or this one, you know. And then Moses drew a line, you know. So all those who blah, 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 you know, who are on Yahweh's side and stand over here, and all those that feel that they're going to camp, as you say, you stand over there, see. And I think 1,000 of them died. I mean, there's the earth opened up and swallowed them down. You know, and here Yahweh tells Moses, now I want you to come back up again. Now this is his third trip coming up. See, the second trip he gave the first ten stone, you see. And he showed him the six-day creation. It was called down, see, because of the disturbance down there. See, so Yahweh calls him back in the third trip, and he gave him a recapitulation. Is that the word we used to always use back in the day? A recapitulation. Well, it was like a rerun of the six-day creation. Then he turns Moses' attention aside to old Lucifer, see? Got that bad boy in the garden, you know. And so Moses was able to understand now why they were acting the way they did. And so Moses comes back down with the table stone that he brought up there, that Yahweh had written on, and that Moses brought up, rather. And so they came back down and they built the tabernacle, and they got the tabernacle was completed I think it was 40 days, something. Was it 40 days of the tabernacle?
40 days.
They were 40 weeks. That's right, I'm sorry. Because it's like keeping it in track with the same with a woman. It's like 40 weeks with pregnancy.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So it's the same thing here, 40 weeks, you know. And eventually, all of those that, you know, just to make a long story short, all those that came out of Egypt died in the wilderness. Now their offsprings, those that were born in the wilderness, you see, went all over to Jordan and inherited their final
promised land.
Their inheritance, but it was a physical inheritance.
Surrender.
You see, and so the pattern when I used to hear ministers say, well, you know, this dictates or this kind of takes our picture, you can see how certain things that happened back here, you see, are really going on today in this age of grace where we are now. You know, you had the those that were born in the wilderness inherited got their inheritance, you see, and they cried for a king, and Yahweh gave them Saul. And then he did 40 years, as he ruled for 40 years, and then David, he ruled for 40 years, and then after that, Solomon for 40 years, you see. And then after Solomon's rule, you had your the Israelites' conduct was in question again, and Yahweh just gave them up to Melchizedek, you see. And that's where they were put into bondage again. Now what this is this showing that over and over again, Yahweh forgiving these people. I mean, that conduct was in question ever since they came out of Egypt, you know, and also over in Canaan land, you see, all the way through the captivity stage of 490 years captivity, and they still had issues, you know. They were complaining, their conduct was bad, they were complaining about things, but then Yahweh still, you know, it would say the specter should not leave Zion, I think, you know, in other words,
should not leave Shiloh.
Shiloh, right, that's what it was. Meaning that he
should leave Judah until Shiloh come.
Yeah, right, which means, you know, that he is the groom, and Israel is the bride. And you see that same principle, you can see it back here, coming out that garden, see? Even though she was the one that was deceived and not the man, they still came out that garden, you see? She caught up with him, she followed him, but she caught up with him and they come out there together, you know? But there was a division, you see, like right when I was talking about the division here, it lines up with this same plate here, see? They came out together, pretty much hand in hand, you see? And that shows forth a division of the sexes, you see, coming down. But in terms of Adam as a figure of Yahshua the Messiah, pursuing his bride to restore his bride back unto himself, that is the same. That is in a reflection of Yahshua and his bride, right here on the Day of Pentecost. See, that woman is clothed in the sun here, which shows forth in unity. You see, just like out and see the difference between this point of the history of the game and the restoration of this woman being placed back is about 4,000 years. See, from the fall, see, and Adam all died. See. So from the fall of man all the way to the restoration, you see, you can see how 4,000 years can be summed up in one little particular episode where it shows how Yahweh took the woman out, that's symbolic to the soul being taken away from the spirit. And Yahweh presented the woman back unto the man. That's just like 4,000 years of that history being in one particular episode where he's restoring the woman back unto the husband man, see? And it's a beautiful thing, man, when you can see it, where you can see how these symbols can mean so much. They call them cameos when I was in graphic art school because it shows, it's like right here, that little circle here, these are cameos. It tells a whole story in one setting, you know? And so that's what that woman means, that's clothed in the sun. It's like 4,000 years of pursuit, you know, from the time the woman was taken out and was headed down into that darkness all the way till when the woman was restored back together with the man, you see? And we can see just about all that in this one plate. But we also know that the story be told from here, you see, all the way down to the Day of Pentecost, you see, right here. And see, the woman was drawn out, see, and then she was restored back unto the man. So that is a reflection through Adam and Eve's historical events. That is a reflection or a type of Yahweh, Yahshua's, that reflects Yahshua's bride, you see. Because both of them are the two Adams, and one is fulfilling what the other one, you know, what the other one started, see, the second Adam completed. Somebody give me one more scripture and I'll be down. And that would be Colossians 2:9.
Colossians 2:9. Mm-hmm. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the supernal nature of Yahweh in bodily form.
For in him dwelleth all the supernal nature of God in bodily form, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, go ahead.
And ye are complete in him.
See, now you are complete in him. Mm-hmm. See? Now, that happened on the day of Pentecost. Now, when your Pentecost comes, you see, when Yahweh showers you with the gift of the Spirit, which is the knowledge of how he accomplished your salvation over and over again. We can see that. I'm looking at how he accomplished my salvation by just coming down here and seeing how the pattern works with the historical events of the world and what, and it made clear his purpose and plan, what he's doing. And that's what he was telling those Jews back there. He said, now you search the scriptures and to the law and to the testimony, if you speak not according to this word, there's no light in them, see? Now we can see now how he earned the cost to be the boss, you see, because he laid down his life for his bride, just like Adam laid down his life for his bride, you see. So it says you are complete in him, right? Mm-hmm. Go one and then complete that scripture.
Which is the head of all principality and power.
See, he's the head of all principalities and powers. And a lot of times they thought he was being real cocky, you know, here he goes again, bragging on his father, my father this. When you see me, you see, when you see the Father. But it was true. It was the Father in bodily form. And you are complete in him. Go ahead.
In whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands.
See, now you also circumcised without the circumcision made with hands. See, in other words, like the Messiah. When he came in fulfillment, you see, when he entered into, like the high priest, when he entered into that most holy place, you see, he entered in, you see, and this was inside a tabernacle. But now with in a spiritual reality, we can see how this one entered in, you see, without, not in temples made with hands, but see, but into heaven itself, you know. And so those are those things that I just wanted to share with you, that because, you know, it's what keeps me coming down here, you know. I mean, all of us got problems, you know. You know, mine has been financial problems for so long, you know. But then when you look at what you've been given, the opportunity to come down here, and not only here, you can be laying in the bed. A lot of times I'll be laying in the bed and I'm driving the car, and Yahweh show me some things. See, and that's a treasure. Because, you know, every little bit of information you get that Yahweh gives you, and you receive that, that is a precious treasure in bodily form, you see. And with those words, I thank you.
Our next speaker will be the Dean, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good evening, class.
Good evening. And,
I enjoyed
the previous
speaker and the things that was brought out. And I want to address a few things because I'm looking at the scripture lesson. I want to see if I can touch on that. But the most important things, I want to see if we can take off some of this flesh. I'm talking about that we have on right now. But we want to do it by utilizing the scriptures. Now, there's been a lot on my mind, and it's a funny thing how slick that satanic spirit is. Now, I had something on my mind, but I can't help myself. The scripture lesson came up, and I thought I'd better go ahead and just hit that. Let me have 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, let me have 11 and 1. Now you watch and see how slick and how smooth that old boy is. Talking about Lucifer. Why? Because he is disguised. He is hid from the unwise and the knowledgeable. Or those who are educated fools. You see, thinking they're wise, but they're not. But I never thought he was so smooth that he could come right into the school and deceive a whole lot of folks. Well, the truth is right here. Let's start at one. Let's go. Please.
Would you that you bear me a little bit in my folly, and indeed you do bear with me. For I am zealous over you with a zeal for Yahweh.
Read on.
For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin.
Now that's how, read on. Go ahead, read on.
But I fear, lest by any means that the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety. So your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in the Messiah.
Now hold it right there. Paul is speaking in this present kingdom age. That means he's talking to us. And he's looking back at the Messiah, how he walked around for 3.5 years, healed the sick, causing the blind to see, the dumb to speak, and the deaf to hear. Healing all manner of sickness. But he also witnessed the death of the Messiah. As a matter of fact, he was a party to it.
Right.
Talking about the apostles all. But he also went further back than that. He went all the way back into the garden. I'm talking about the apostle Paul. And he witnessed by way of a vision and a revelation what happened in that garden. Now, just as already brought out that this is a cameo, so is this play too. It tells the whole story about what happened in the garden. Just like this is telling the whole story what happened to the bride and the woman. So here's Paul in the present kingdom age. He's talking about what's happening to the bride or the woman or us, if we will, if you will. Alright? Now read that one more time, that verse. Let's move on now.
But I fear,
read,
lest by any means
read,
the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety.
Read on.
So your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in the Messiah.
Now Paul's looking at this event right here and seeing how the bride or the woman is being deceived by Lucifer, who is an incorporeal being, like or not, to serve and to honor and to carry out the will of the Father. Talking about Lucifer, he is an obedient son. Just like, that's what angels do, and he's one of them. But his will, his mission is to oppose. That's what he has to do, and that's exactly what he's doing. I'm talking about Lucifer. But he has to be slick and smooth and cunning to achieve that goal with the woman. Because he's not going to deceive the man. He's not going to deceive the man or the husband.
That's right.
But he goes to the weak. You see? Which is what they call the Omega. You see? You know, when you have a litter, you want to know who the Omega is, who the weak one is. The one who gets kicked, you know, who gets kicked, that's the Omega. In other words, if there's eight puppies, and there's some food here, everybody wants their food. But the weak one, they're going to just kick them on out the way. You want to get ours first, then you get yours. Everybody with me so far? Mm-hmm. Now read on now Paul said, I'm fearful that you're going to be deceived just like Eve was deceived. But he's talking to us in this age.
That's right.
Let's read, please.
For if he that cometh preaching another Messiah,
read on,
whom you have not preached,
read,
or if you receive another spirit,
read,
you have not received,
come on,
or another evangel which you have not accepted,
come on,
you might well be with.
Now look, that's the state and condition of the school. Mm-hmm. Things have changed.
Right.
And folks want you to know things have changed. And if you're not changing with us, we're going to leave you behind because you ain't caught up. Mm-hmm. Because what has been taught, it ain't sound enough for us today. It ain't good enough. That's what's being taught. That's what's been said. We're moving on. You with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Couple more verses, then jump down to 13. Read on.
For I reckon I was not a whip behind the various chiefest apostles.
Come on.
But though I be rude in my speech,
come on,
yet not in knowledge, but we have been thoroughly made manifest among you in all things.
Now this is Paul saying this. I did not walk with the Messiah on the Palestine Judean hills. Even he said it. He says, I was one born out of due time. That's what he said. And I'm not worthy to be an apostle. Why? Because I persecuted the assembly of Yahshua the Messiah. Why he choosing me? I'm talking about the Apostle Paul talking that he was not worthy. One born out of due time. But Yahweh is not slack concerning his promise. He knows how to deliver and carry out, you see, his will through the man.
Yeah.
Now jump down to 11, because I got to move and I don't push for time. Read.
11?
Maybe 13. 13? 11's fine.
Okay. Wherefore?
Read.
Because I love you not, Yahweh knoweth.
Read on.
But what I do, that I will do.
Come on.
That I may cut off occasions from them which desire occasion.
Come on.
That wherein they glory, they may be found even as we.
Mm-hmm. Maybe I did want 13. Read on.
For such are false apostles.
For such are false apostles. Mm-hmm. Read on.
Deceitful workers.
Deceitful workers. Read on.
Transforming themselves into the apostles of the Messiah.
Transforming themselves into the apostles of the Messiah. Now we always point to the Pope. Mm-hmm. And we always point to the Pope. That's why I went right here. Mm-hmm. The leper.
Yep.
We always point to the Pope.
Mm-hmm.
We point to those jackleg preachers. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're obvious to those who have a trained eye.
Mm-hmm.
But man, we never look to say, look at ourselves. All the ones in the school. Around the time I heard about. I'm talking about the ones, and listen, even ourselves.
That's right.
You got to look at you. You see, examine yourself and see if you be in the faith. Mm-hmm. You see, but we always looking without and not within. All right? Transforming themselves, read on.
And no marvel.
Read on.
For Satan transformeth himself into an angel of light.
Now look, Satan, Lucifer, transform himself into an angel of light. Oh, there's so much. I want you to pick up real quick Genesis 3 and 1, and then we're going to move. Come on, keep reading.
Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as ministers of righteousness.
So, don't be surprised if his ministers, Lucifer's, because they're transformed to an angel of light. So don't be surprised if his ministers do the same. Give the appearance of carrying out the will of the Father, but they're carrying out their own mission. Because they don't have a will. Yeah. Somebody was talking about how these guys were running with the movie you're talking about?
Oh, Ten Commandments?
No, you're talking about the preachers together.
Preachers of LA.
The preachers of LA.
Yeah.
Run around flossing.
You sure do.
You know what flossing means, right? You need to floss your teeth.
Yeah. Right.
You make them look nice, shine them up. Good one, that pearly white.
Yeah.
Or looking like Flavor Flav, putting on the bling bling on the lips.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm talking about?
Piercings.
Looking good. Yeah. Have everybody looking at them. Mm-hmm. And that's what these preachers do. I got a Rolls Royce. And when you get out, hey, come on, that's a nice thing to look at. Mm-hmm. Well, my pastor got a Rolls Royce. Mm-hmm. And we bought it for him. And proud of that thing.
Oh, yeah.
That's what we did.
That's right.
Yeah. The love offering. Then I'm going to go visit his church at 3:00, and I'm going to be a guest speaker. Mm-hmm. And then the pastor of the church give praise and thanks and say, we want to give a love offering for Pastor so-and-so for visiting our church and bringing us the message. So dig into your pocket. You follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's how you get his Rolls Royce.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they eat it up, yum, yum. Mm-hmm. You see? But that's what we do. Now, we're going to fast forward. I'll keep reading. I'm going to make another point.
Whose end shall be according to their work.
We know.
I say again.
Come on.
Let no man think me a fool, if otherwise yet as a fool receiveth me, that I may boast myself a little.
Okay, that's good enough. Then I made my point here. Now, fast forward. We're going to head back to the Messiah. Now, we way over here in the present kingdom age. And that's what the Apostle Paul said. How that Lucifer, who is an angelic creature, or a being, or an incorporeal angel with the carnal mind. And he's in the same state and condition that we are in. In other words, he's a woman just like us. And he too needs a seeker savior, but you know what? He ain't worthy of a savior. Now here we are in the present kingdom age. Now we're going to head on back to the end of the post-Diluvian age and look at the state and condition of the man at that time. When the Messiah, Yahshua, was walking around in Palestine, on the Palestine Judean hills, in a physical body with his posse, which are the 12. You see, we're going to look at the state and condition of that man and how carnal that man is, and how he behaved, but we're going to go a little further back, and we're going to head right on back to the scripture lesson. Mm-hmm. We're going to see the same thing going on, because we got a pattern, Doc. Matthew 16 and 1. I know I called Genesis, I want to make a point. If you pick up Genesis, then pick up Matthew 16 and 1. Now, the reason why I wanted Genesis, because everybody heard about Adam and Eve in the garden. And everybody also know, and it was already brought out, it's on the chart right here, how the man was put into a deep sleep, you see, was the type of death. And it says his spiritual immersion. In other words, Yahweh put him in a deep sleep. And sleep is a type of death. And then Yahweh pierced him inside, you follow me? And he draws the woman out. The woman immersed in Yahshua. Mm-hmm. You see? And then Yahweh wakes him up and he presents his bride to the man. Mm-hmm. That's the division of the sexes because the woman is drawn out.
Yeah.
You see? And then he puts him in perfect harmony, perfect peace up here in the garden. In other words, he's looking at his woman or his bride. Mm-hmm. Talking about Adam. Because Yahweh had to show us the man, that he both masculine and feminine within himself. So he draws the woman out of the man. Mm-hmm. And show us, when we look back, that he's both masculine and feminine within himself. Mm-hmm. But he is still Yahweh made manifest or taking a residence in that body. Carrying out the purpose or the will of the Father. Talking about the man Adam. And a part of that is drawing out the woman and bringing the purpose on down. Mm-hmm. Oh man, so much. All right? Now let's read. Pick it up 3 and 1. I mean, not 3 and 1, but 3 and 3.
Genesis?
Where the conversation takes place with the serpent and the woman. Because it's about the bride being deceived. Mm-hmm. That's what the scripture lesson was about. The bride being deceived.
Yeah.
So that's where I'm picking it up at. All right? Let's read.
But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim hath said, ye shall not eat of it.
Is it 3 and 1?
That's 3 and 3.
Three and 2 then.
You want where the serpent was more subtle?
That's what I want right there.
Genesis 3 and 1.
Yeah, now look, here he is. And listen, that ain't a bad looking picture either of him either. Mm-hmm. Dead now.
Yep.
You see? Now watch this, read please.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field.
Read on.
Which Yahweh Elohim had made.
Now here's the deception right here, Doc. Mm-hmm. Soon as you hear the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, here come that carmine looking at the doggone snake.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Don't see the man. They don't see it. They look at the doggone snake. Because mm-hmm. it's a reptile and they're familiar with that terminology or that nomenclature. Mm-hmm. All right? Let's read.
And he said unto the woman.
Now here, he's talking to the woman. Now see, Dr. Kinley paints these plates for us to look at. It is a visual, you see, of the Bible so that you can get understanding. You see, but see, in that it is a visual, something to look at physically, so you get an idea how it plays out in your mind. What happened? But there was only two physical persons in the garden. That's Adam and Eve. Mm-hmm. And he painted the serpent on this tree here. But if you were to look at the tree, just like you look at any other tree, there ain't no snake wrapped around it. Mm-hmm. It's a principle that he's trying to get you to see that it was the tree that deceived her. Because the tree of life was not in her at that particular time.
Yeah.
The tree of life in Yahshua the Messiah. Mm-hmm. So now she's looking at the tree and she's being deceived by Lucifer. Mm-hmm. And he's talking to her in the garden. Now watch that movie is. Read on, please.
Hath Elohim said,
read,
ye shall not eat of.
Oh, come on now. Has Elohim said? Mm-hmm. What do you mean has Elohim said? Didn't Adam say? Because Adam was Elohim.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Read on.
Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden.
Now it's Adam who told her don't eat. So like you tell your kids don't do this, don't do that. He told her what to do. Mm-hmm. And what not to do. Mm-hmm. Read.
And the woman said unto the serpent,
read.
We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden.
Come on.
But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die.
Now that's what the bride said. I'm talking about being obedient. Now watch how slick this boy is. This is what he says. I mean smooth in the same tone and challenge her integrity. Or challenge the statement she just made. Mm-hmm. Now watch. Come on.
And the serpent said unto the woman.
Now the serpent said, or Lucifer said, mm-hmm. the corporeal angel that's operating within her consciousness. Mm-hmm. Come on, folks. She was in heaven with him.
That's right.
Come on, read.
No death will you die.
Hey, no, he was going to die. Now, what are you talking about? What the hell she know about death? No death, you're going to die? Read on.
For Elohim doth know.
Oh! Now Elohim doth know, read.
That in the day ye eat
there. Now when you touch the tree, read.
Then your eyes shall be open.
Oh, read on. You're going to be knowledgeable. You're going to know everything. You're going to see it. You're going to recognize it. As a matter of fact, not only will you see it, Not only you recognize it, you'll be just as tough as Adam himself walking through the garden. You see, saying this is a chicken, that's a lion, that's a cheetah, that's an elephant, that's a giraffe. That's how you gonna be. Your eyes gonna be open. So he said, don't eat it. Come on now, read.
And ye shall be as Elohim,
read,
knowing good and evil.
You're going to be as good as Elohim, or you're going to be as good as your husband, Adam, knowing both good and evil. Come on. Now that's how smooth he is. And guess what? He had her attention. It's just like if you were at home with your wife or your partner, whoever, and every time you turn around, she got something negative to say about you. What you wear, the way you wear your hair, you see, the cologne you use, you follow me? The way you wash the doggone dishes, and you're taking too long to come in, and every time there's always something. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Or maybe get graphic up in here. Always doing it wrong. And then the next door neighbor, hear that? Say, oh, Mr. So-and-so, Mr. Wunsch, I love the way you mow your lawn. You just move so proud, you get through so fast. And you know what? I like those plaid short pants you be wearing. Who gave them to you? Your wife got them for you? You follow what I'm saying? Oh! You know, you get a haircut. She said, I can't stand that haircut. She said, Mr. Watch, I love that haircut. Who's the barber? You follow what I'm saying? That's what happens.
Yeah.
So the next door neighbor giving you all the compliments, and the one you're with talking, you start talking about you like a doggone dog.
Yeah.
My point is, the neighbor got your attention. Adam told her what she could not do, but guess what? He got her attention. Talk about Lucifer. You ain't gonna die, girl. You're gonna be just as wise as Adam. That's how smooth he is. That's how he operates. That's how he works. Deception. In her continent. Now remember, he is an incorporeal being. And it was Eve who produced him in her consciousness. Having a conversation. In the garden. Why they supposed to be in a heavenly state. And at that time, they were. So he is intercoursing, you follow me, with the woman. Talking about Lucifer. That is the true sex in the garden, if you will. Alright? Now watch. Now we're going to take this thing right on down to the flesh. Matthew 16 and 1. Now look. Oh, there's so much. See, what the founder said, that same devil that was in the garden was that same devil back here with Noah. It's that same devil that's operating right now.
Yeah.
Matthew 16 and 1. Now, this is the Messiah walking around the Palestine Judean hills, listen, in a physical body, looking just like any man on the earth. Me and you, if you will. The difference was, he appeared to be sin. He appeared to be physical. He appeared to be carnal. And listen, everything he did, somebody was always challenging him. Now what he did. They on his case about what he's doing and what he ain't doing. I'm talking about the Sanhedrin Council. I'm talking about the Pharisees, the scribes, the Sadducees, the publicans. All of them. They're always on this case for what he's doing, what he ain't doing, or what he's not doing.
Yeah.
Stay with me. Let's move. Come on, let's go.
The Sadducees also with, I mean, the Pharisees also with the Sadducees.
Oh, wait a minute. The ones who believe in the resurrection and the ones who don't believe in the resurrection, they're all together. Partying together, and they confront the Messiah. Come on now, read.
And tempting desired him that he would show them a sign from heaven.
Oh, wait a minute. Wait. You mean the Pharisees and the Sadducees after the Messiah, Joseph's son, or Joseph's married boy, for a sign. Why, as Nicodemus said, nobody can do the things that you do. Because he's healed the sick, called the blind to see, the deaf to hear, and the dumb to speak. Who else is doing that? Walking on water. Father, just walking on water, just gliding on water. Who else doing that? You see? Who else called the shots? Cast your net on the right side. And a whole lot of fish. Who else doing that? Who's called the shots? Say, Yahshua the Messiah. Come on, let's read now.
He answered and said,
now this is what he said, because he understands their thought, their motivation, and their intent. I'm talking about Yahshua the Messiah. He understood that carnal mind. Come on.
When it is evening, you say, it will be fair.
Now listen. He went right to where they are. You walk, you say, now when it's evening, read on.
You were saying it's fair weather, for the sky is red.
That's what you say. The whole day done passed. Read, please.
And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering.
Now, wait a minute. But in the morning, it's foul weather. Mm-hmm. But in the evening, what you say? What you say in the evening?
In the morning and the evening.
In the evening, you say what?
When it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red.
Oh, in the evening time, you say it's fair weather, nice weather, for the sky is red. Mm-hmm. But in the morning time, what you say?
In the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the
sky is red. Now, in the morning, you say, it's going to be foul weather. Like you know what the hell you talking about. Mm-hmm. He's taking something simple they deal with every day. Mm-hmm. Now, watch him punch him right in the mouth. Come on, read.
Oh, ye hypocrites.
He said, oh, you hypocrites. Read on.
Ye can discern the face of the sky. But can you not discern the signs of the time?
In other words, you can do what? You can tell, you can discern the face of the sky. But you cannot discern the signs of the time, because they were looking for a sign. Mm-hmm. Alright? Read on.
A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign.
A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. Mm-hmm. In other words, when it was time for Judah to take care of business, Yahshua says, I picked 12 of you, and one of you the devil. He said, the one that's going to deceive me is who I'm going to get a sock to. Mm-hmm. Now the 12, who was walking with him, they all looked at John and said, hey, who is it? Who's the one that he picked? He told, but they missed it again. Let's read.
And there shall be no sign given.
He said, there ain't going to be no sign given. Read on.
But the
you sign, adulterous.
But the sign of the
and wicked generation. Mm-hmm. You damn hypocrites. Mm-hmm. You can use a textbook to prove your point. Because mm-hmm. Dr. Kelly endorsed it. But when I use it, we got issues.
Yeah, issues. That's right.
It ain't the same. I don't get it. I don't understand it.
Yeah.
But you can use it to rebuke or to reprove a principle that I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. But I use. Now you're changing the rules now. Come on, folks. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Let's read.
There shall be no sign given unto it but the sign of the prophet Jonah.
Read on.
And he left them and departed.
Now, wait a minute. Oh, man, there's so much. But we ain't going back there because we hit some place out. See, with the prophet Jonah, remember, Jonah was supposed to be obedient because Yahweh told him to preach, correct? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And he told him to go to Nineveh.
Mm-hmm.
And he takes his butt to Tarshish.
Yeah.
But on the way, Yahweh say, listen, fool. I told you to go to Nineveh, but you're going to be disobedient and go do what you want to do. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to show you. Just as he was walking the waters, he called the tempest to be in the water. Scared the heck out of everybody to the point that they ain't back there asleep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Folks on ship were scared. And that's there where the ship is too heavy. You see? And so here he gets up, he says, oh gosh, I already know what the problem is. Mm-hmm. And they say, who are you? And they say, aren't you? He's a Hebrew. He said, you're a Hebrew. Well, your God is Yahweh. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And he already knew the problem was, you know, he just cast himself right on over. Mm-hmm. And when he cast himself over, that was a type of death.
Yeah.
The fish swallowed him up. That's a type of burial. Mm-hmm. And then he spewed him up on the seaside, on the seashore, correct?
Yeah.
That's a type of burial.
Resurrection.
I mean, resurrection. Mm-hmm. So he says, it ain't going to be no more signs. I gave them to you. Mm-hmm. That's what he said. I ain't going to give you no more. I gave you a sign. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But you won't hear it. Sign of the prophet, that's all you're going to get. Now you discern that, or you 8605 here. Mm-hmm. Let's read, please.
And when his disciples were come to the other side, they had forgotten to take bread.
Now wait a minute, he's contending with the Pharisees and the Sadducees, talking about Yahshua Messiah. But he had his posse with him. They heard, there were witnesses. They know what was going on. So here come the apostles, right? And what happened?
And then Yahshua said unto them,
read,
take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees.
Now he says, take heed and beware of what? The leaven of the Pharisees, excuse me, and the Sadducees. Now watch how this carnal mind is at work. Read, please.
And they reason among themselves, saying,
read,
it is because we have taken no bread.
He said, oh my goodness, we ain't took no bread. He said, hey, listen, they talk among themselves. What? You forgot the bread? Come on, why don't you go get some bread? You had time to get the bread. Why you gonna get the bread? You know you need bread. You know how we are? And Yahshua looking at us, oh my goodness, look at these fools. Read, please.
Which when Yahshua perceived.
Now he understood. By the way, they were asking about some doggone bread. Mm-hmm. Read, please.
He said unto them.
Now look. He said, come on, y'all. Y'all need to catch on. Read.
Oh, ye of little faith.
Read.
Why reason you among yourselves?
Read on. Because
ye have brought no bread.
Now why y'all tripping on the fact that you don't have no doggone bread? Mm-hmm. Wake up and smell the coffee. Read, please.
Yet understand neither remember the 5 loaves and 5,000 and how many baskets ye took up.
Hey, come on, y'all walking with me. I'm running this thing. You remember that? And you ain't got no bread. Read.
Neither the 7 loaves and the 4,000.
Uh-huh.
And how many baskets ye took up.
Uh-huh. Do you remember that? Come on.
How is it that ye do not understand that I spake not to you concerning bread?
Read on.
But that ye should beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees.
Now he said, this is what I'm trying to get you to see. I ain't talking about no doggone Roman Mills bread, no home fried, no Weber's, no cornbread, biscuits, waffles, you see, pancakes, whatever. I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about that egotistical misdirected personality. That carnality. That is incarnated in the man. Mm-hmm. You see? But I'm grooming you. Because I'm going to listen. I'm going to cast that bad boy out. Through knowledge. And give you the tools and equip you to do this very same thing that I'm doing. Mm-hmm. But I ain't talking about no dog on bread. I'm talking about the man that's running around here asking for a doggone sign and acting like they know about the whole thing. But the law of the prophets, you want to poo-poo the law of the prophets. That is the autobiography of what I'm going to do when I show up in the flesh. And if you look at that, that is your sign.
Yeah.
All right? Everybody with me so far? Mm-hmm. Now, Lucifer, Satan, the prince of the air, Beelzebub, what everyone going to do to you, he's slick, he's smooth. You see, he knows how to operate. The leper, I'm talking about the Pope. Caesar. All of them. That's him. Now watch. Head right on back to the scripture lesson. We've got to line this thing up. Right on down. I didn't call the scripture. Y'all call it right. I didn't call it. I just walked in here. 28:1. Let's move. Let's read.
Ezekiel 28.
Now you watch this. We way back in the book Ezekiel. Joshua ain't even showed up on the scene yet.
Right.
But I tell you who was on the scene. Lucifer. That old bad boy right there.
Mm-hmm. My buddy.
You see? Now, I want you to pick up one. And somebody pick up 15. Not 15, but 13, real quick. So I started 13 first, we're going to head back to 1.
Okay. Thou hast been in Eden, the Garden of Eloh.
Oh, wait, that's what I want right there. Thou hast been in Eden, the Garden of Eloh. Mm-hmm. Now watch this, go back to 12.
Son of man.
Uh-huh.
Take up a lamentation
of
the king of Tyre.
Come on!
And to him, thus saith Yahweh, thou sealest up the sun.
Read on.
Full of wisdom.
Read.
And perfect in beauty.
Uh-huh. Read.
Thou hast been in Eden, the Garden of Eloh.
Read on.
Every precious stone.
Stop right there. Now why the hell is he telling him that? That's what I'm after. Why is he talking to him this way? Now go back to 1. We're going to straighten this thing out today. I'm going to tell you why. Because the same one that was in the garden was the same one in the city of Enoch. Mm-hmm. He was the same one who built the Tower of Babel. Mm-hmm. Or should I say built the city of Enoch. Mm-hmm. He was the same one, I'm talking about the second Babylonian Empire.
Yeah.
Talking about Nebuchadnezzar.
Yeah.
And his army. Yahweh gave him that power. The Medes and the Persians, which is what we're reading about right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Alexander the Great.
Yeah.
You follow me? Pagan Rome, the Caesars,
mm-hmm.
and Papa Rome. That same damnable devil.
Yeah.
Disguising himself as kings. Mm-hmm. You see? As kings. As the holy ruler. Mm-hmm. The Vicar Filial Dei.
Yeah.
The representative of Jesus until he gets back.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Cain sitting on the throne.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Posing himself as the man. Mm-hmm. Would it be like the Most High?
Yeah.
I'm talking about Cain. Nimrod. Mm-hmm. Who's going to sit at the top of the tower.
Mm-hmm.
Now here we are talking about Tyree. Mm-hmm. Read, please.
The word of Yahweh came again unto me, saying,
read on.
Son of man, say unto thy... Say
now, wait a minute. Now, you go tell him this, Ezekiel. Son of man, you tell him this. Read.
Say unto the prince of Tyre.
Now, you go talk to Tyre. Let's get one thing straight. Tyre is not Lucifer. He ain't Satan. He ain't that bad.
Mm-hmm.
But he's manifesting the characteristics of Satan.
Okay.
Through a body. Mm-hmm. As Tyree. Or in the personality as Tyree.
Mm-hmm.
Or Joe Williams.
Mm-hmm.
Or Barack Obama. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I can move on, but you get the point.
Mm-hmm.
You see?
Mm-hmm.
He's manifesting the principles or the characteristics of Lucifer when he was in the garden. And this is how he's doing it. Watch, read on.
Thus saith Yahweh.
Read on.
Because thine heart is lifted up.
Because thine heart is exalted. It is lifted up. It's because of your what? Your egotistical, misdirected personality.
Yeah.
Walking around because you got a crown on your head.
Mm-hmm.
You got a crown on your head. You sitting on the throne at the top, sitting on the seat of authority. That's why you cry and have a problem. Because
mm-hmm.
you are high and lifted up in your heart and in your mind. Read, please.
I am Elohim.
Read.
I sit in the seat of Elohim.
Read on.
In the midst of the seed.
Uh-huh.
Yet thou art a man and not Elohim.
Uh-huh.
Though thou set thine heart as the heart of Elohim.
That's your problem. You can't be me. You can't be a creator. You're a pseudo-creator. You want to act like you're the creator. But you're not the creator. You're not Yahweh made manifest. Mm-hmm. You're not Yahweh, the creator of heaven and earth, who is the ultimate source, the substance, the limits and the bounds, the origin, the essence of all things. Not sir. Mm-hmm. Who is creator of this stellar universe. Mm-hmm. Can't be that. That's not you. You were created just like everybody else. Mm-hmm. Let's read, please.
Because thou art wiser than Daniel.
Uh-huh. Come on.
There is no secret that they can hide from thee.
Read on.
With thy wisdom and with thine understanding,
read on.
Thou hast gotten thee riches.
Read on.
And hast gotten gold and silver into thy treasure.
In other words, you got a Rolls Royce now because the people bought it for you. Mm-hmm. Because of your pipes, the things you said. Mm-hmm. And this is one of the things they walk around and say. I'm blessed and highly favored.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm a son of God. Lady told me the other day, and I am not lying. I rebuke this. She told me. I ain't lying. Now, her blood pressure was 204.
Ooh.
You with me so far?
Yeah.
Over 120.
Oh, wow.
That's what her blood pressure was today. Mm. I ain't claiming it. I rebuke it. Normal blood pressure is 120
yeah.
over 80 mm-hmm. or 110 over 70. Mm-hmm. That top number is your heart pumping, mm-hmm. and that bottom number is your heart resting. Mm-hmm. Everybody with me so far?
Yeah.
I'm talking about the state and condition right now in this present kingdom age is the same one was going on back there. Mm-hmm. I'm blessed and highly favored. I say, why don't you go and listen, I rebuke it in the name of Jesus. I say, then you, I'll wait until you get that blood pressure down before I pass you for your DMV physical.
Yeah.
Because see, truck drivers, people who drive commercial vehicles, uh-huh. their blood pressure has to be under 140 over 90.
Yeah.
Why? Because 140 over 90 on two or three occasions is by definition high blood pressure. Now, if you have high 140 over 90 one time, that don't mean you have high blood pressure. You know, I mean, I go to the dentist, my blood pressure way up there mm-hmm. until I get out. Mm-hmm. Some people see a white coat, their blood pressure's up there. You see, some folks get on the freeway, you know what, they got road rage, their blood pressure go up.
Yeah.
They might have had a monster drink. There's a whole lot of things that are going to happen, because they got to argue with you. Anything, your blood pressure will go up 140, you see, over 80, or maybe even over 90. You get my point?
Yeah.
But my point is, when you going to tell me, I rebuke it in the name of Jesus, you know my answer is, well, you might as well leave out of here, because Jesus ain't here helping you right now. And if that be the case, why you walk around all these doggone pills if you blessed and highly favored? Y'all get my point, right?
Yeah.
I'm talking about the same thing condition that was going on back here with Ezekiel. And at the end of the post-millennial age, it's the same thing that's going right now in the sixth dispensation. You get my point now? Mm-hmm. I'm blessed and I'm highly favored. Let's move. I'm almost pushed for time. Read on, please.
By the great wisdom and by thy traffic, thou hast increased thy riches.
Read.
And thy heart is lifted up because of thy riches.
Read on.
Therefore, thus saith Yahweh.
Read on.
Because thou hast set thine heart as the heart of Elohim.
Read on.
Behold, therefore I will bring strangers unto thee.
So since you are high lifted up, arrogance, can't tell you nothing, think you know it all. Like this lady come in, I said, my goodness, that's sure a nice fine purse you have. I know you didn't buy it. How'd you know that? I said, believe me, I don't think you bought it. All that talking you doing. You see, walk around, had one of those nice fine cars. I'm talking about one of them real expensive ones. But your blood pressure's out of control because of your disobedience. No other reason. But you want to blame it on everybody else. And listen, I'll tell you how folks lie. I said, 5'6", right? 5'6". Talking about you weigh 220 pounds. I said, now I know good one, you don't weigh no 220 pounds. Who wrote that? Did my people write it or you wrote it? I said, great, you weigh no 220 pounds. She said, well, I'm not exactly sure I am. I said, well, you're 50, you should. I mean, I'm not sure how tall I am. I said, well, you're 50 years old, you should know how tall you are by now.
I heard that.
I said, but since who wrote this? Did you write it there? I said, I figured that, because you ain't no 220 pounds. I said, well, we're going to tell you how tall you are and how much you weigh. She said, I think I'm 5'5". I said, maybe, maybe not. But anyway, the point is, you found out she's 5'6". Because she thought she's 5'5".
Yeah.
And then we found out she was 245 pounds. I said, now that makes sense. I said, because you should not know 220 pounds. You can't tell me you look like you're 220. I know what 220 look like. But I also know what 250 pounds look like when I see it. I might be off 5 pounds, 3 or 4 pounds here. But 245 pounds and 5'6", that makes sense why you got high blood pressure. You follow what I'm saying? When you should be somewhere around 135 pounds, and that's considered overweight, but closer to 120 pounds. Do you get my point?
Yeah.
Everybody with me so far?
Yeah.
I'm talking about how we deceive ourselves with this egotistical misdirected personality. You see? That's being orchestrated by this boy right here. Because he makes sure that you don't see you. He got a bailout, folks. He got a bailout. The flesh. I'm pointing to Yahshua Messiah. Because see, some folks think, oh, they see Jesus on the cross. I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. I'm letting you know Jesus is not your Savior. For a number of reasons that I ain't got time to get into. Jesus is not your Savior, nor is Allah, Buddha, or Krishna. And your pastor either. But I tell you one thing for sure. Lucifer can transform into an angel light. Look like any one of us. And tell us any old thing. And once he got you, he know he got you. Just like he got Eve. Deceived her. Bamboozled her. Hoodwinked her. Whatever you eat. He got her to eat that fruit. Now that she is, she gave it to her man. Adam knew better, but he willingly or willfully laid down his life for his bride. He was obedient to death, just as Yahshua Messiah was obedient to death. Let's read on. Come against out of your own time. Let's read.
I will bring strangers unto thee, the terrible of the nation.
Read on.
And they shall draw their swords against the beauty of thy wisdom.
Read on.
And they shall defile thy brightness.
Read on.
They shall bring thee down to the pit.
Read on.
And thou shalt die the death of them that are slain in the midst of the sea.
Come on.
Wilt thou yet say before him that slayeth thee?
Now watch, wait. Now Bill Cosby. Everybody know he's in the news here.
Yeah.
I just had to take this opportunity because it just presented itself.
Yeah.
Now he was high lifted up.
Oh, yeah.
Cliff Huxtable.
Yeah.
America's dead.
Yeah. Look. Bill Cosby, a.k.a. Cliff Huxtable, right?
Yeah.
He's a TV character transformed into an angel of light. You get my point? You didn't get my point.
Well, I didn't know that he was considered an angel of light.
What I'm talking about is a principle. The angel of light is anybody who presents themselves one way as being goody two-shoes, but deep down inside, you're a conniving, deceiving, dirty dog. So what these women are saying is that he doped me with pills and sexually molested me. Or, you see, he put a Mickey in my drink. And next thing I know, I wake up, and next thing I know, I have no clothes on. They're saying he violated me. But he used his fame and his glory because I'm thinking I'm going to get something or he's going to help with my career. But he had another agenda. But the reality, she had the same agenda that he did. She's trying to use him to move forward, and he figured I'd use you while you using me. I'm just telling how it is. I mean, it's not like my intent. So now, the opportunity, decades have gone by. Not one, not two, not three, but four decades come by now. Folks are coming out of woodworks. Well, he did this to me, and he touched me here, and I did that, and I have your father there, and I'm not defending him either. Nobody was in the policia. But you guess what? Now you see an opportunity to profit. Now here you manifesting your colors. Lucifer. Transform into an angel light. Now you miss good show. And I've been mentally scarred for all these years. And I had to go see a psychiatrist because, you know, he touched me like that. And he violated me. And I didn't want to do that with him, but come on. Come on. I'm not defending him either. Not at all. I'm saying, if it was that damn bad, why you go to the authorities and report it? If it was that bad, and you've been so mentally scarred. And I'm not defending him. I'm saying you have the same state, you are in the same state condition that he's in, and I'm saying, you're adulterous and you're an adulterous and wicked generation. You're whitewashed sepulchres. You're full of dead man bones. In other words, you look good, but guess what? Inside, you ain't real and you ain't genuine. But now here's an opportunity to profit. Now you want to bring him down and defend him. I'm saying you're just as guilty. Not all, but there were some. Not all, but there was some. That's all I'm saying. But I'm not defending him by any means. That many people don't pop up and say things unless it's so. That's what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is your intent was to use him to profit off you. And I'm not sanctioning anything that he did. Or that he did, because I wouldn't. I don't know. But if you say he did it, why you didn't do something about it? Why you wait 40 years to say something? You knew he was married. Well, you didn't destroy his career. Why you want to destroy it now? I want to destroy his career. I was clear as possible. You get my point? That's all I'm saying. You know, I know we're out of time, but there's so much. You see, down, jump down to Green Next Tree Dorsey, we're out of here. Where we left off. Where were we at? We at 4:15 yet? 14:15?
No, we're
at 9. He was in Eden. It was 13. Jump to 13. We get out of here. Where it says thou was Eden.
Thou has been in Eden.
Thou has been in Eden. Talking about, listen, talking about Lucifer. Now he's talking about Tyree and his manifestations. His character. His reputation. But he was in Eden. Read on, please.
The garden of Elohim.
Read on.
Every precious stone was thy covering.
Read on.
The sardius, topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold.
In other words, and you look good. Read please.
The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created.
And you know how to articulate to achieve a goal. Mm-hmm. Read, please.
Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth.
And listen, I set you, so I put the crown, look here, I put the crown right on you. I put the crown right on you.
Yeah.
I made you think that you were the man. And listen, you behave exactly like on high lifted up. You lifted? Come on, read, please.
Thou wast upon the holy mountain of Elohim.
Read on.
Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire.
Hey, listen, I let you walk around with all my angels. Mm-hmm. High lifted up. Mm-hmm. Read on. I already knew you were going to see me because I set you up to fall. Mm-hmm. Read on.
Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day.
In other words, as much as Bill talked about the state and condition of the black man, their actions, their attitude, and their behaviors, and they had him high and lifted up. Mm-hmm. Believe me, when he fell, they not coming to his rescue.
Right.
Oh, yeah. So you're going to talk about us like a dog and attack our character, going to find out, we find out you just like one of us.
Mm-hmm. Worse.
Yeah. Yeah, really.
You got fault just like us. Mm-hmm. Like Yahshua says, you wicked and adulterous generation. You follow me?
Yeah.
You're adulterous and wicked generation. Mm-hmm. You want to pretend like you got it going on, but in reality, you know what? You are no different than me. Mm-hmm. You like everything I like. That's why the Pope said, hey, listen, you guys wrong for letting these guys violate these little kids, and you do nothing about it, and you cover it up. Mm-hmm. You wicked and you adulterous generation.
Yeah.
You hypocrites.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But you want to tell everybody when you're in the pulpit what to do and what not to do and how to be and how to be. Then you turn around and do the same doggone thing. You say, and cloak it.
Yeah.
Transform it into an angel of light. Mm-hmm. Come on, read on my moment that we got here. I apologize.
From the day that thou wast created till iniquity was found in thee.
Read on until you got exposed. Now here, Bill got exposed. Mm-hmm. He got career lords. He got money.
Yeah.
He got wealth. He can hire an attorney to draw this thing all out as long as he wants. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, his reputation is shot to hell.
Mm-hmm.
He had to resign from every board, and all of them have to come down. Okay. Every last one of them have to come down.
That's right.
From the top to the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Read, please.
By the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned.
Now, that's good enough right there. In other words, even though Yahweh, talking about Adam, cast Cain out, he put a mark on his head. Mm-hmm. When he put that mark on the head, that's what exalted him. Mm-hmm. To make him think that he was better than all his other brothers and sisters. That when they saw him, they were told, do not harm him. Mm-hmm. So he can walk around with a little attitude and a little swag, and guess what? I got the mark his daddy put it on my head. And you know what? You can't do nothing about it. So back up off of me. Mm-hmm. I hope and trust you guys got something out of this today. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
Well, I truly thank the Father for allowing us to have class this evening, and we hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30, Sunday morning from 11 in the morning. The last Sunday of the month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 to 10:45 a.m. And this Sunday, we will have a business meeting at 10 a.m. So come back again to study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies and stand for the doxology. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both before all times, now and ever. Let us all say
hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Oh, boy, oh, boy, oh, boy, oh, boy.